Well, Stony Brook is a knuckle down, get to work place. But let me say, with great honor, I was the first student who graduated there without any negative points. That means I got no penalties all the while I was there.
What would you get penalties for?
Oh, for raucous behavior in the dorm, or disobeying masters, or getting down on your studies and not doing what you should have done. Just not obeying the rules. Mm-hmm. So I considered myself a little white angel, you know, with a halo and everything. But I was very proud of that. But I felt a sense of obligation to that school. And and I will say this, I've never had better teachers than I had at Stony Brook.
So Mr. Goldberg put together an advanced science class. It involved field trips to Argonne Labs and all that stuff. Well, one day he walked into class and he said, gentlemen, there were five of us in the class, you all did very, very poorly on that exam last week. And there's this silence, and he said, I obviously failed to teach the material properly. I'm throwing out the results of that exam. We are going over the material again and we're going to do it again. He took responsibility for the learning process. That's character. Now, that's just a little thing, but 50 years later,
it still resonates.
It's still there. I remember things like that, where integrity, honesty. I would have had a hard time lying to somebody who was that straight up and took responsibility himself.
So I feel when I talk to Stony Brook people, as I did the headmaster just a few days ago, I want them to know how grateful I am. I at this end of my life, now I go back and I think about the investment that they made, what I learned, and it's priceless.
During the late 1930s, I was 10, 11, 12 years old. I would remember Sunday nights, my father would go somewhere in the metropolitan area of New York to fill a pulpit. Churches then had Sunday night services.
Yeah.
He would bring home some kind of honorarium, $25, $35. Somehow I was awake, and I would wait for that 2 o'clock train at Stony Brook to get in. Mm. My father would come off it. I'd hear the door shut. I knew he was home safely. He was up at 7 o'clock the next morning to be at breakfast. Mm. And that honorarium, $25, $35, went into the scholarship fund.
But character itself has a source. It springs not from moral maxims, rules of conduct, proverbs, or thou shalt nots. Its derivation is higher. It grows out of religious experience. The effective religious experience that is the result of the gospel of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
This is not just a job. This is a vocation. This is a calling. And this is something we looked for very much when we hired faculty. Did we sense that these people got that? Because I don't want a bean counter that it's 5 o'clock, I'm punching out. No, I want someone, because I had seen my father do it, and I had seen other people do it. So, but my favorite expression was, you know, at Stony Brook, faculty are the horses. We're going to ride hard all day and put them up wet every night. That was what I used to say. and faculty used to kid me about that. But Stony Brook was something that you just poured your life into.
I first heard of Stony Brook when my mother said to me one day, Carl, your father and I have heard of a school out in Stony Brook, out in Long Island, called the Stony Brook School. And we're thinking that may be a good place for you to go. And I said to her, Mother, you'll never get me there.
starting with character, but it's a wholeness of academics, physical development, and spiritual. And that has been outside of my family, no institution or group of people have had a greater impact on me.
Only 100 years ago, a different age, a different time. No internet, no cell phones, no TV. Women's right to vote and the civil rights movement were in the future. Electric lights and horseless carriages were novelties. At the turn of the century, the discoveries of modern science posed great questions. Was the world only 5,000 years old? Did man evolve from apes? Was the biblical account of Genesis true? The debate was front page news. Christian educators wanted and needed answers. In the early 1900s, leading Protestant evangelical ministers around the country gathered to start what rapidly became a national phenomenon, a summer Bible conference called the Stony Brook Assembly. The purpose was to teach educators, providing thoughtful, biblical answers to the great questions of the day. They understood that science was revealing the details of God's great creation, and that scientific discoveries were consistent with Scripture. They taught Christians to think. A veritable tide, educators, clergy, and ordinary people by the thousands flooded into tiny little Stony Brook week after week, every summer, for generations.
There was something here where the Stony Brook School now exists. It was in 1909 that the first meeting of the Stony Brook Assembly met. They met here in 1909, although it didn't have many buildings. They had a huge tent under which they presented meetings with the leading Bible scholars of the United States and England.
Pastors all around the East used to send their Sunday school teachers for a week to the Northfield conferences, where they would get instruction on the common curriculum for the coming Sunday school year. And these people were coming back from Northfield saying, we're not getting the kind of instruction that we want to pass on to our students. And a group of ministers, mostly Presbyterian but not entirely, led by John Fleming Carson, said, we need a different place, a different kind of instruction for our Sunday school teachers. And they looked at a place in Montrose, Pennsylvania, and Carson had purchased a piece of property here. It's now the Methodist Church in Stony Brook's parish house. Mm-hmm. So he had a liking for Long Island, and he convinced the others. In 1907, they purchased this property. In 1909, they put up a tent on his front lawn. Used to think that it was here, but no, it was literally on Christian Avenue. Mm-hmm. And by the next summer, the auditorium had been constructed.
They also bought up, wisely, 300 acres of building places, conference grounds, and a delightful spot down by the harbor, which included the Three Village Inn. The Stony Brook Assembly once owned the Three Village Inn. Then in 1910, this auditorium was built. The auditorium that we seated in now was totally different. It was just a flat floor. It eventually became a gymnasium floor. But it was built as an auditorium to seat about 1,000 people in here. It was in 1915 that Hopkins Hall was built. That was a building that preceded Frankie Gateline Memorial Hall. And then in 1918, the Chapman Parkway was built. And shortly after that, in 1922, the school was off and running.
And till 1958 or so, the summers were occupied with Bible conferences and Sunday school training instruction.
The call, therefore, to counter theological liberalism and to ground a cadre of future leaders in the fundamentals of biblical theology was one of the driving forces that possessed these men. It never did take them into the maelstrom of the fundamentalist, modernist debates that were raging at the time, because they were no ivory tower theologians, and because they were never extremists, either in practice or in belief. But it possessed them and drove them because they believed that the future of biblical Christianity was at stake, and that they had a chance to do something about it if they could harness young men of promising intellect to the defense of the Bible.
Reverend Arnold C. Gabelein was an assembly teacher and one of America's most beloved teachers of biblical prophecy. His visionary son, Frank Eli Gabelein, a 21-year-old Harvard graduate, was chosen to be the fledgling school's first principal, a title that quickly changed to headmaster.
He was a gentleman in every sense that you could use that word. And I was trying to be like him as an educator. I was trying to be like him as a Christian. I was trying to be like him as a leader, and I think it was a remarkably good model to choose.
I didn't expect to stay only that first few months, and one day I got a call, and Betty Snyder called and said, Dr. Gabelein wants to talk to you. This was in November, our first year. I walked in, and the first thing he did was grab me by the shoulder and says, let's pray. And so we started to pray about my staying at Stony Brook. And that was par for the course. A couple of years later, he said to me, do we have to go through this every year? Can't we just say you're going to stay?
He was a man who believed in character before career. And Christian character, believed that was the root of real solid character, and wanted kids to have a vision of that kind of idea for themselves. He taught Bible. One of the, I think his contribution in the teaching area was as a senior Bible, and the book of Romans would be the exercise there, and it would be a workout. And those kids had to really dig in and study the book, one of Paul's great epistles, and memorize long passages, and that kind of thing. So it was a privilege to work for him, because he was a man, he was a great man, because of his sense of excellence in all these areas of life.
Well, Dr. Gabelein was a tremendous influence on me, the headmaster of the school. As a teacher, his own disciplined life, he was a genius. Not only was he a good teacher, he was a top-flight educator. He was a pianist. He'd fill Carnegie Hall as a piano player. He was a tremendous mountain climber. He'd written a book on it. He was a tremendous chess player. He'd written a book on how to play chess. And just that combination of talent and very godly man dedication, one man, was a tremendous influence on me in high school.
My grandfather, in many ways, he was actually very old school in terms of being continental, that old kind of European continental thing where he wanted to have meals prepared for him. There was this formality about him.
Dr. Gabelein made the interview for about 8:30 in the morning. Well, I was in Foxborough, Mass, my home at that time, and they told me it would take about 5 hours to get there. So I left about 3 a.m. in the morning, and figured I would stop at a gas station somewhere before I get in there and shave and clean up a little bit, and did so. But when I stopped at the gas station, I realized that I didn't have any shaving cream or any razor with me, and I had 3 days' growth, and I looked kind of grungy. But I said, uh-oh, well, there goes this interview. But when I first met Dr. Gabelein, the awe of this man just impressed me so much. And then after a few minutes, realizing he cared about how I felt, he wanted me to go get some breakfast, he wanted me to relax, he wanted me to rest for a while when he realized I'd been driving for 6 hours. And I was so impressed with his caring about how I felt. I mean, more than just, well, I'm interviewing you for a job, but let's get on with it and get it over with. He cared. I felt that he really was a caring man. And of course, found out later that yes, he was indeed.
And one morning, he was coming out of his office, and we fell in step and walked over. And I said, well, doctor, we missed you at chapel earlier this week. I always notice when you're not there and someone else is in charge. And he said, well, I had a very interesting experience. He said, once a year, I have a dear friend who loves to play the piano as I do. And he has in his home 2 9-foot grand pianos facing each other. And once or twice a year, we meet and we play piano concertos, we play opera, we play Chopin, we play whatever strikes us. And for instance, he'll take the piano part and I'll play the orchestra part on the other piano. And said, we just have the most wonderful time. And I said, well, now, is this a member of the music faculty? And he said, well, no, as a matter of fact, this man is, I keep forgetting his name.
Albert Einstein.
Yeah, this man is Albert Einstein with the fuzzy hair, you know. And he said, we meet twice a year and do this. And he said, Dr. Einstein is one of my dearest friends.
I will tell you a little humorous story.
Sure.
In that when we had our first child, we had been married, so it'd be 1961, so it was in the fall of 1961, and his wife, I think, encouraged him that whenever a faculty wife had a baby, you'd go over and visit. And he never quite knew what to say. He always thought babies were ugly from what we reputation was. And so he would come in and say, what a baby. What a baby. What a baby. And that way he didn't have to commit himself if it was beautiful or not beautiful, anything else. And then he would quickly leave. And his wife would stay and talk with the spouse and with my wife. And
My memories of him, when I first went down there, I was engaged to Don. And I actually got interviewed by him. So I guess I passed because he didn't call off the wedding. But I found him, he could be a little intimidating. But as I got to know him, he's full of integrity. He is a very caring, wonderful man, and I enjoyed his wife as well. They always watched to make sure that everybody did what was proper, because they were very proper people, but they were loving people.
You don't cross the familiarity line with them. You don't become their buddy, even if you're almost their same age.
Right.
But I called him Frank after about 1964.
I would like to say that he was very human as well, and some of the things that he told on himself were really, really priceless, I thought.
What do you mean?
He had a huge dog named Ciro back then, and he made a point of saying, if you're going to have a pet, and he was very pontifical, you're going to have a pet, you must see to it that the pet obeys its master. Oh, yes. He said, let me tell you a story. He said, when Ciro was a younger dog, he said, I had to teach him to sit. And I would say, Ciro, sit. And he would sit. Ciro, stay. And he would stay. And I thought that perhaps he should be tested a bit. So I put down before him his food. And I said, Ciro, sit. And he sat and stayed. Then I thought I should perhaps test him further. So he was in my study. So I went out of the study, closed the door, went down the hall as quietly as possible, or went down the hall, and then tiptoed back, in his words, I applied my eye to the keyhole. Said, what do you think I saw? What? I saw another eye looking at me. The other
side. Prior to that, Dr. Gabelein called me in, sat me down, sat next to me. Jacques, I understand that you are going to hitchhike across country. Yes, sir. He put his arm around me. If you are going to make such a trip, I would like to advise you on a few places that you should see.
Not what you were expecting, I suppose.
And I almost burst into tears.
Yeah.
But he would care. And that this great distant figure would even know about what I was up to. And he advised me to hitchhike down Route 66. And I did. And that journey, among other things, caused me to decide to become an American citizen.
Well, he was accosted by a groundskeeper who lived about where Mr. Brown's house is now. What are you doing here? And he relayed the story about that there was talk about a prep school coming here, and he was going to survey what it was about because he was being asked to be headmaster. Well, the groundskeeper thought this was also preposterous. He had never heard anything about prep schools, and he immediately chased him off the grounds. He had to go back to the station to wait for the train back to New York City. Well, he got a chance to come back and look. And then remarkably, miraculously, accepted this rather bizarre task. He became the headmaster of his here for over 40 years. This man, a pioneer in Christian education, began and developed and set his mark on this school and a mark far beyond its brick entrance. He set his mark on the Christian church of his day. His books such as The Pattern of God's Truth or Christian Education and Democracy earned him a national reputation. They influence educators to this day.
I wrote to Dr. Gabelein and said, I was wondering whether by any chance you had a vacancy. Mm-hmm. I could teach English and Bible. Mm-hmm. And I got a quick handwritten letter back saying, as a matter of fact, we do have a vacancy.
Yeah.
And I would like very much to meet with you and talk it over. Mm-hmm. I'm going down to New York on such and such a date. If there were any possibility of your coming down in the train, we could meet at Grand Central Station. Or Penn Station, I've forgotten which.
An amazing place for an interview, I suspect, yeah.
That was where my initial interview was.
Did you get, most people we've been talking with have talked about the interview lasting no more than 5 or 10 minutes.
Right, it was very,
it was
in a coffee shop.
Yeah.
While we drank coffee at the counter.
But what struck me about that leather sofa and that little carpet were the worn places in the leather and the worn places on the carpet. And they were elbows and knees, might have been. Now, I knew by reputation that Frank Gabelein prayed for every student every day.
By name.
By name. Mm. And I knew that he also prayed for a roster of alumni in sequence. I knew this only by rumor. He had obviously never made any claim about it. What I didn't know was what happened next. He reached to the top of one of those bookcases where there were two stacks of the old-fashioned file cards, 3x5 or whatever they were, heavily wrapped in rubber bands. I mean, it wasn't a single band, it was like 20 on each stack. And he picked them up, and they were about, you know, this thick. He picked them up and he showed them to me. He said, these are my, I don't often show this to anyone, he said, but these are my prayer requests. And these are my thanksgivings. And I just want you to know that I have moved your daughter from my prayer requests to my thanksgivings.
Wow.
Now, this is within 5 minutes of our having come from St. Charles Hospital being told that she was dying. And then he did a very typical thing. He gave me a shove and sent me out the door. There was no arm around the shoulder with the senior who was about to run away.
Yeah.
But he had conveyed his message simply, directly, and with some measure of reluctance, I think. And then it was over. Now, I did not run or walk back to Hegeman Hall. I floated back, and I was in the door, and I could not have been 60 seconds. That's very, very close. I walked in the door. My wife was weeping for joy. The doctor had just phoned, and our daughter would live.
Wow.
That was our fourth year, so we decided to stay for 30 more.
I can see why.
Yeah.
It's a life-changing event.
Yeah, indeed.
Yeah.
I had the privilege, Ethan, of probably experiencing exposure to the last of the early great legendary people. Pearson Curtis, of course, was one of them. He was known as PC. He was as eccentric as all get out. I mean, really, and I mean this respectfully, an odd man. But he was like Frank Gabelon. He was a Renaissance man, and he loved his literature. And he would go away in the summers to his island getaway in Maine, Bailey Island. And he was a camper and all this kind of stuff. But boy, in the classroom, he was brutal. I mean, he really made you assimilate the literature. And I always think it's funny, whenever you meet a Stony Brooker from the 1950s until PC left, we can all to this day quote Samuel Coleridge Taylor's Kubla Khan. In Sanan Duda Kubla Khan, a stately pleasure dome decree. Where, I mean, it's just a string of almost meaningless words. But he pounded that thing in that old-fashioned teaching style into our heads. And here I am 60 years later, and I can still remember it word for word. And other things like that. Curtis was a very tough grader, and he held you to very high standards. But you never forgot what you picked up from him.
Energetic, unbelievable energy that man had. And so, you know, I think that's probably some of the things that I've picked up over the years is that I'm never down. I am a positive person.
When he used to go out on a trip, field trip with the kids to West Meadow Beach, which is a beautiful place, and he would take along a file card, you know, ordinary file. And when he walked down the path where he could possibly see some of the girls in partial clothing, he put this up against his head and walked down. Now, that impresses a young man who is looking for any opportunity he can make to see a young girl in undress.
You know, he was extraordinary in that he was well-versed, of course, in English and all kinds of literature. And I was very impressed with that kind of thing. And deep down inside, he had a real ability to connect with you. And I always felt he had my best interest at heart. But I'm sure it was not just me. I think he was able to impart that he made you feel one-on-one. And so I felt I learned a lot of history and literature and English from him. And at the same time, I felt I learned a lot about how to be a person.
But as an Englishman, you walk by his classroom, you might find him under a desk or on top of a desk or with some kind of a uniform on, doing Macbeth or whatever. And it just came out of it. And a kinder, gentler, but very firm individual you can't meet.
I remember him distinctly right here at that pulpit, giving a vivid, dramatic presentation on Belshazzar and the handwriting on the wall, and what it means to be a lightweight. You are weighed in the balances and found wanting. What it means to be a lightweight. And then leaning over that pulpit and peering out into this audience of boys, and specifying how not to be a lightweight, both as a student, as an athlete, as a man. I think character before career is probably as well personified in Pearson Curtis as in anyone I've ever known.
Pearson Curtis is a legacy of his own making, really. He climbed with Gabelein on a lot of those serious climbs. Yeah. And once with a world-class climber, Dr. Gabelein was talking with, ad infinitum, they discussed everything, mm-hmm. including climbing. And Dr. Gabelein realized he needed to introduce Pearson Curtis because he was busy making camp. Mm-hmm. And he said, I'd like you to meet my climbing companion, Mr. Curtis. He said, Curtis from Maine. Mm-hmm. That was it. He taught us how to deal with salt water. He made sure we could swim. He would teach us how to make a good waterproof way to sleep, mm-hmm. out on the sand in the rain with a tarpaulin, because mm-hmm. none of us had any of that equipment. Mm-hmm. And he taught us sailing. And he was one of these people that made it so clear. I'm so glad he wrote the school hymn, mm-hmm. because that's what Stony Brook was about. That's what Pearson Curtis was about.
Marvin was the epitome of efficiency, getting things done and done right. But I think that both Floyd and Marvin, though they were really bred in the old Frank Gabelein tradition, mm-hmm. they, as was PC, were trusted by the students. The students felt, yes, these men were very demanding, mm-hmm. but they did have our good at heart. But you didn't feel there was real warmth between Marvin Goldberg and the students. Mm. It, of course, his initials were always joked on,
yep.
About by the students, MWG, my way goes. Yeah.
But also, he really invested himself in us. One summer I stayed there and worked at the conference ground that took place at Stony Brook,
the
assembly in the summer. And he came out every day so that I could pole vault and to just coach me in pole vault.
Just you? Yeah.
Yes, just me. And but he also required doing things the right way, so that I remember the first time we could have beaten Poly Prep, which was the best
competition. Yeah,
yeah, the best athletic school at in our Ivy Prep School League, yeah. at the when we were in the Ivy Prep School League. The first year we would have beaten them. One of our runners, Bert, broke curfew a week before to go to a concert and something without permission, and he did not let him run, even though it meant that year we would not be our first year to beat Poly Prep. We had to wait a year or so after that.
Marvin Goldberg was dedicated, focused, very Christian, a wonderful example of Houghton College. He was involved with music. He was involved with science. He grew things and involved the kids in whatever was going on. Mm-hmm. He was just one of those people that had to be a kind of father figure. There, I thought of my teachers and coaches at Stony Brook as surrogate parents.
One of my proudest moments happened in the 1970s, early 80s maybe. I recommended him to the Penn Relays for honors. And on Saturday afternoon in Franklin Field, Marvin W. Goldberg and an athlete that I had competed against at Temple University named Bill Cosby were honored together in the middle of Franklin Field for their contribution to track and field in the United States. Wonderful, wonderful tribute to him. Ethan, I don't know how he did it. He simply took kids who were willing to commit themselves to his discipline. I mean, here's a perfect example of what mentoring is, what the discipline of the coach-athlete relationship is. And if a fellow missed practice or was late for practice, Goldberg would meet him after dinner and be out there on the field or on the track getting the work done that should have been done at the appropriate time. It was a great inspiration.
My first step into education there, I'm not sure what I really expected. Mm. But my first impression among the people that were there, not just Dr. Gavelin, but the others too, were they were so helpful, so willing to be there if needed. They weren't pushing any of their ideas upon me as an incoming teacher, but they were willing to be there if I needed help or had any questions or whatever. And that really impressed me, Ethan. Yeah.
And I never thought that whether it was Marvin Goldberg or Frank Gabeline or Pearson Curtis, I never felt like they didn't have my best interest at heart. But the interesting thing is that I knew they had everybody else's. They knew you personally. They knew the students personally. There weren't too many of us. You know, I think there were 50 or 60 in my class, and they were in all forms, but they knew who their students were. They eventually learned what their strengths and their weaknesses were, and they worked toward it. And they worked to try and bolster and support and bring those things out in you. And I just remember that people like Pearson Curtis, he knew me very well, and he would sometimes, you know, he was just a wonderful man who would kind of put his arm around you and walk and let's talk and whatever. And so was Marvin Goldberg. And there were other wonderful people, Donald Murray, Warren Hershey, were all really just incredible men that I've not forgotten them. Never forgotten who they were, and Johnson, Mr. O. Floyd Johnson, who we had the same middle and last name.
See, all my life I was in independent schools. I went to one, and then I was teaching and head of two, Stony Brook and then Atlanta.
Westminster, yeah.
We had an experience. We called them company men. Mm-hmm. I mean, they devoted themselves to the school. Mm-hmm. They didn't ask what they'd get, how much they'd get paid or this or that. My dad would call them in and say, I can pay you this much next year.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dr. Gabeline.
Yeah.
And that, I inherited that. Mm-hmm. And in a sense, it made it easy, but it also gave me a bad conscience because we couldn't begin to pay them enough.
Mm. So the relationship was very, very cordial, and if I asked questions, they would be there. And we need to also include in the numbers, names, that you mentioned Don Marshall and Floyd Johnson. Those were the faculty who kind of quote unquote stuck because faculty come and go, but they were long term in for the long haul faculty members. And then Peter Hale came shortly after me, and he was
older, but and much more experience in some things of life, so that they were always there to share with. But I think as a faculty member, if you did your job, they just kind of, they were happy with you. And
Jim Barton was a big influence on me, because I lived in Shadyside. Mm-hmm. And he and his wife Arlene would, Steve Newton and I were the proctors at Shadyside. Yep. And once a month we would be invited down to the kitchen to have scrambled egg sandwiches on rye bread. Mm-hmm. To this day, I still make scrambled egg sandwiches.
Some habits are hard to break.
Yeah. And after Jim left Stony Brook and I made contact with him, we exchanged Christmas cards until he died. Mm. And he was, he had left Stony Brook and went to the Salvation Army and was an officer in the Salvation Army.
Mm. How did he influence you at Stony Brook?
He was my biology teacher, and he taught me more about life than what grows.
Oscar Floyd Johnson, a wonderful, godly man, tough as nails. He had been a very fine running back as a small man, both here at school and at Davidson, where he played football. And he had this gravelly voice, and athletes learned to jump when he spoke.
Jim had a wonderful intelligence, sense of humor, but he was really mischievous. For instance, one night he figured out the clock system for the whole school. And at sometime after midnight, he went down and changed all the clocks in the school so that the wake-up alarm went off at 4 a.m. instead of 7 a.m. So the wake-up alarm goes off. All the boys in Johnston Hall crawl out of bed, dress. You know, they're just so sleepy, you don't even look at the clock. All came down the stairs, waiting there at the dining room, you know the scene. And all of a sudden, somebody looked at their watch and said, "What in the world? It's 4 a.m. You know?
He wasn't a smoker, but because smoking was forbidden, that's something he really wanted to do. And so what the foolish boy did was to get a great big plastic laundry bag, and he'd take a puff and fill the bag. And so when Dr. Gabelein came along, he had the evidence all ready for him.
It was always tradition for the senior year to go climb the water tower and leave its mark. Well, we decided to be a little more clever. And so Danny David Enko and I decided we were going to go climb the tower and mark the tower. And we went through somebody else's room to get out. That was our mistake. I won't tell the name of the student that turned us in later, but anyway, we went out, we climbed the tower. Danny had never gone up a ladder like that before. I had volunteer fire department experience, and so I was right behind him and I kept encouraging him. We went up and we took care of marking the tower. Came down. The next morning, there was 3 inches of snow on the ground. No footprints to the water tower. Dr. Gabelein called the school together and wanted to know who did that, who marked the water tower. And what we had done is we didn't paint the water tower like every other class had done before. We painted it on a sheet, class of 60, so we didn't do damage to the water tower. Well, this other classmate turns us in, and so Danny and I are in Dr. Gabelein's office in his home, and he said, "You boys are in trouble. You damaged school property." And I was quick to point out, no, sir, we did not paint the water tower. We did it on a sheet. And he looked at me and he said, Mr. Huber, whose sheet was it? Dead.
Somebody put flour in the organ and they fired that thing up and he had this great cloud that came up and took care of, I think, the speaker and the introducer and everybody. They had pranks, everybody. And there was this one young man came as a language teacher and he had a small car, and I can't remember what the make was at this time, but they put it down in the jumping pit, you know, so.
Jumping pit?
Yeah, the
oh, for pole vaulting?
Long jump.
Yeah, long jump pit, okay, yeah.
And, of course, that drew announcements from in the dining hall, no more putting people's cars in the jumping pits. And the next day they put it in between two trees in the woods. they were always creative about that sort of thing. But yes, I would say that pranks were always in order. We always played pranks.
One day, soon after we arrived, I was very young. I was 21. Two of the students knocked on the door, and I opened the door, and they shoved in this dead rabbit on a board, hoping for me to pass out or something. Instead, I brought them in and made them dissect it in the kitchen. And took care of that little problem.
It's pretty crazy.
They had tried this on another faculty wife prior to my time at that apartment, and it had worked beautifully for them. So they were hoping to initiate me into the club, I guess.
We used to have this, there was this gesture we were around, like if you make a stupid mistake, you go. Floyd Johnson got so tired of that that one time he said, the next guy that does that is out of this class. It was a math class, junior algebra, I think. And I was a gifted student, so I hated it when I made a mistake. And one day I made a mistake in class, and I went, I only got this far, and I remembered, as far as he was concerned, that was it. 4 units out of the classroom. And it was near the end of term. I had to stay over an extra day at the end of term to work off my units for that simple little gesture.
And then I remember we had to have fire drills periodically, but often they were used as punishment if we had not been behaving the way we should. So once in Hegeman Hall, I remember, they had somebody in the dorm who I will not name, but who did not have the same command over the students. And so we had been particularly rambunctious one night, and so he decided on a late night fire drill, where we have to come down in our pajamas on these ladders outside and so forth. And so it soon developed into a fashion show. And so the students began dressing in more and more wild clothing as he had more than one fire drill that night. And finally he had to call for PC to come up, who basically commanded enough respect. And so just let us know that, you know, this can go on all night. You're not going to win.
I knew when they were going to tie Mr. Wood's car to a tree with a chain. Long before they did it, I knew when they put Rosie's car in a jumping pit before they did it, and Dr. Gabeline would come to me and say, did you know this was going to happen? I said, of course. Why didn't you stop them? I would say to him, because you're going to see what an outcome is, and you're not going to feel badly when you see the outcome. I don't know whether you've had this story or not, but one night the boys took a cow out of the field and brought it in and up to the third floor and put it into Rosie's living room. They took all of his furniture out, put this cow in. Did you hear this one?
And almost every morning, when I walked over to breakfast, 7:15 in the morning from my house, I had a sinking feeling. What am I going to do if I find that all the tables were
on the football field or something?
Or all the cutlery had been removed from the kitchen. What are we going to do?
A great sorrow on the occasion of my first res gestae, the yearbook. Here we have the daily grind, and some member of the class was responsible to record all the high points in the course of the year. And somewhere along in the daily grind in my first year is this notation: a massive water fight on the third floor. Mr. Lockerbie blamed the wrong people as usual. It was those two words, as usual. They cut me to the quick.
And I remember one time when I was a senior, we had a terrible water fight in Hagen Hall, is that it? Mm-hmm.
The senior dorm.
Yeah. In the senior dorm, and water was all over the place and we had caused great havoc. And I remember Dr. Gabeline coming to the top of the stairs and he said, "You know, I don't know who caused all this, but I bet you Charles Johnson's involved." With that stentorian voice of his, and I never forgot that.
One thing more. Do you remember when Admiral Byrd spoke and an alarm clock went off in the piano?
Yeah. Well, the Major Davis called.
Major Davis called me in and he said, "Peter, we have information that makes us sure that your brother John was the one who put the alarm clock in the piano." And he said, "We are putting him on the train back to Pensacola, Florida." Now, I know Stony was a Christian school, and we were inculcated with that feeling of not telling lies and trying to always tell the truth. But I had to do something, because I could see my mother and father waiting in Pensacola for my brother. So I said, "Major Davis, I don't want to bring this up, but my mother has a problem. What do you mean? Heart. Little heart problem. And I'm just afraid, sir, John arrives home in Pensacola, I'd be devastated." And he thought about it, and John stayed.
Well, walking back, the business manager, Gilbert C. Moore, lived in the house Bruce Lockerbie lived in afterwards.
Sure.
Right there, practically that corner.
Down by Shady Side, down there.
Opposite Shady Side.
Yeah.
And the lights were out in his house, and Dave Swanson said to me, "I'll bet you can't throw a rock through his window."
And
I said, "Dave," I said, watch me. I picked up a rock, threw it through his window, and we walked on. Broke the window, thought nothing of it. Well, at about 2 o'clock that morning, my father got me out of bed. And he said, "Did you throw that rock?" I said, "Yes, sir, I threw that rock." My dad had gone through the dormitories with a rake, asking everybody. He knew a Stony Brook student had done it. "Had you done this and that?" And he got to Dave Swanson, and Dave said, "I didn't do it." "Who were you with, Dave?" "I was with Don." Dave didn't tell on me, but my dad knew.
Yeah.
Okay. My father expelled me from school.
No kidding.
Then and there. And PC went to my defense. And he said, I don't know what he said to my father, but it was something like, "Good gosh, class night a prank," or something like that. "You're going to kick him out of school for that." Yeah. And the upshot of it was, in those days, underclassmen put on white shirts and we waited on the luncheon after graduation.
Yeah, yep.
Well, I had to put a white shirt on. I had to wait the tables at that luncheon with everybody saying, do you know what he did? Well, what he did was throw that rock, but what he also did was get suspended from school instead of kicked out and handed 72 units to work off on the coal pile. And for one solid week and a day or so afterwards, I put in 8 hours a day on the coal pile outside Hegeman Hall after school started.
Oh, man.
Did I ever get in trouble?
Yeah.
But, you know, those are the facts.
Yeah.
But legends come from facts.
Yes, they do.
When I got back to as a headmaster, a student asked me, sir, did you get climb up the water tower and throw a rock through the chapel window?
That's funny.
What did I think of all the boys?
Yeah.
It was a unique experience. I mean, there were times when they were a real challenge. I remember actually when our youngest daughter, Cheryl, was born. We lived in Johnston Hall at the time. And the pranks would sometimes get to you. And I recall one time when I was actually bathing Cheryl, and all the lights in the dorm went out. And this had happened a couple of times. So I just went out in the corridor and said, I am bathing a three-week-old baby here. Those lights better come on, and they better stay on. And they came on, and they stayed on. I'm not sure. I have an idea who the culprit was, but I won't reveal that.
What stands out in my mind is the great fellowship we had with one another, the relationship between faculty and their wives, and with the students, we had a lot of good times with that too. Traveled. One of the things at Stony Brook that I got to do was to travel to China and also to Russia. And I haven't even been to England, but I've been in those places. And so I've had a lot of opportunities by working there and enjoying a lot of different people with whom we're still friends.
I wasn't familiar with the boarding school life, like, you know, Thad. Mm. So I didn't know what to expect, but I loved it. I loved getting to know the students. I loved serving. I was traditional headmaster's wife because I had such small children. And our first year there, the three of them were in three different schools. They weren't at Stony Brook yet. Mm. So I wanted to be home with the children. And so I was the traditional headmaster's wife, and I just poured myself into the school. It was easy to do.
It was like being in a very large, loving commune in many ways. We were all in it together. We didn't have a lot of money, and we had a lot of children on a regular basis. And we all had a lot of children, it seemed like. And so we were all, the mothers in those days, it was like the 50s and 60s, there was more of the idea of being the 50s housewife where you stayed at home with the children. Mm-hmm. And so there, later on, many of us reached out and had other jobs. But at that time, we were pretty much stay-at-home moms, mm-hmm. and we banded together. And our children, they just had the run of this wonderful campus. It was theirs, and they felt like they owned it. In fact, they would actually stake their claim. It would be Donnie's trees and Danny's rock, and they would name different things. It was theirs, you know. They were faculty kids, and they could move in a group. The children would play together, and they could go from one home to the other. And when it was lunchtime, you just grabbed whatever kids were there and fed them. You know, it was
whether they're yours or somebody else's.
Oh, yeah, right. Our discipline was quite similar, so we all got along. And the wonderful feeling that you could, if you needed to, you could go down the hall and have a cup of coffee with someone. You had someone to talk to. Mm. And the children thrived. Mm. They really had a great life there.
When the school began in the fall of 1928,
1922, it housed all of the school operations because it was the only heated building. In that building, there were rooms for about 31 boys from the ages of 8 to 19. 9 teachers lived in that building. The nurse, one of the secretaries. The lower floor of the building was converted from hotel rooms to classrooms. The chapel was there, the dining room was there, the kitchen was there. And in the basement was the first science lab.
I'll never forget one day Marzia said to me, "Mr. Hale, may I speak to you?" I said, "Yes, let's go down to my office." We went down and he said to me, "My religion is telling me that I've got to believe in Muhammad as the prophet or else I'll go to hell. What I seem to be hearing here is that I need to believe in Jesus or else I'll go to hell." Though I must say we didn't preach that.
Yeah, sure. But he's asking the question, yeah.
It came through.
Yeah.
And I said, and he said, "I don't want to go to hell." Now what do you do, what do you say mm-hmm. if somebody comes and says that to you?
Yeah.
I was terrified. I just didn't know what to say. And I sent up a quick prayer. And I think God gave me the answer. I said, "Marzia, I'm so convinced that Jesus is alive and real. I believe that at some point he'll make himself known to you in an unmistakable way." Mm. That was it. And that was his, I think, early in his senior year. I forget, maybe his junior year. But we kept in touch. He went to college in Westmont, mm-hmm. California. He loved being with Christians. He found them friendly and loving. And then his parents eventually managed to escape from Iran, from Persia. And they were living in Italy, and he went to Rome to be with them for the summer. This was after his freshman year in college. And he wrote to me a letter from Rome and said, "Mr. Hale, I just want to let you know that last Sunday I was baptized in a church in Rome." He'd really made a commitment, but he'd not wanted to make it public mm-hmm. until he got his parents' permission.
But there are so many memories of that 1 year. I remember walking down to the village and people rushing up saying they bombed Pearl Harbor. Mm-hmm. And where's Pearl Harbor? We didn't know. And the next day, Major Davis appeared with a uniform. And then they dropped these German spies off the coast, if any of you remember, and he had us all going through the woods with clubs looking for those German submarine spies. And I remember saying, I said, "What if we met them?" Having later fought against these guys and knowing how great they were with weapons, we would have had one terrible time.
A very small reunion this year.
But one of the things I would do to help my father, who some days, you know, my dad needed to go tend affairs of the school, and my grandfather would always be hanging around, so my father would go, this was when I was later a teenager and had a driver's license, my father would say, "Thad, get your grandfather out of here. Take him to the local diner, drive him someplace." I don't know if many people realize, my grandfather was the worst driver in the world. He was either going 6 miles an hour or 600 miles an hour in a car. And so I would be like the chauffeur, and I would drive my grandfather all around, and sometimes it was just to get him out of, you know, get him out, and we'd go to diners and things like that.
And so there were lots of nooks and crannies and hidden places in Hopkins Hall. For example, on Saturday afternoon about 2 o'clock, you might see 12 boys all go into Stu Beckley and Phil Lauder's room. You might wonder why a moment or two later you didn't hear any noise in that room. And for the next 2 hours, no one came out of the room. The simple explanation for that was that in Stu Beckley's dresser, there was a passageway. We took out the bottom drawer of his dresser, and we could all squeeze down through the floor into the locked basement. We would go down there for 2 hours and do things I'm not going to tell you about.
My great memory in my senior year, and I'll try to make this very short, it was a Saturday, and we had a track meet at Van Cortlandt Park in New York City. And on the way home, the plan was for three of us to be let off the bus at Huntington, and we had dates for the evening to go to the movie. And then we were supposed to catch the 10:30 train back to Stony Brook, and you had to be on campus at 11 o'clock, or you paid the ultimate price. And the train got in at 11 or 10:55, something like this. So all during that day, as we drove into the city, Marvin Goldberg kept kidding the three of us. He was saying, he had a very high tenor voice, which we all used to love to imitate. "Now, Gordy, you're going to be back to the campus on time. You're not going to call at 10 o'clock and say, 'Oh, sir, we missed the train,' so you can stay out late. You know what would happen then." And said, "No, Mr. Goldberg, we're never going to miss the train. We will be there." Well, on the way back, he kept kidding us about this, and so they let us off at Huntington. We had the hamburger, went out with the girls to the movies. The movie went later than it should have, and the father who was supposed to pick up the girls at the station didn't show up, and we couldn't leave the girls. The train came and went. The next thing we know, we're in Huntington. It's 10:45. We are in deep, deep trouble. And what are we going to do? You know, it's too far to walk, and we had no money except for the train fare. Couldn't take a taxi. And finally, the three of us said, "The only person we can call is Goldberg." And knowing all that, he kidded us all week. And so they said, "Gordy, you can do this." So I made the phone call. He was clearly asleep. "Mr. Goldberg, I don't know how to tell you this. We're in Huntington. We're stranded. We don't know what to do." He said, "Gordy, did you plan this?" I said, "No, sir. God bearing me witness, this was not planned." "Well, Gordy, stay right where you are, and Mrs. Goldberg and I, or Dorothy and I, will be there right away." Well, about 45 minutes later, they pulled up in their wooden paneled station wagon, picked us up, and I'll never forget it, all the way back to school. You know, we were just terrified that he would be angry at us. But all the way back to school, it was all laughter, all humor, kidding. I couldn't believe that he would treat us this way. Then when he drove us up to Hageman Hall, he said, "Now, Gordy," and the others, he said, "You understand that there will be a consequence. I can't mitigate the consequence. And on Monday, you're going to have to meet with Mr. Marshall and find out what the penalty is." Well, the penalty was 4 weekends on campus shoveling coal or waxing floors, I forget. So, yeah, that was a bad moment. But more important than the discipline was the way Goldberg treated us. I learned so much from the emotion. You apply that experience over and over and over again in your life as a leader. When you're responsible to lead a staff, when you have to speak disciplinary words to people, you remember a moment like that, how a guy handled it so graciously. He didn't take cheap shots at you. He accepted your word. And yes, there was a consequence, but he handled it in such an elegant way.
And so I talked with Jim at length, and I went into Dr. Gabeline and I said, "I know I'm asking for a lot, but I believe in Jim. I believe in his future. I believe in what he's going to do in this world. If you will let me be personally responsible for him and not suspend him, I'll take that responsibility." And so he very kindly agreed to that. And I explained to Jim that his foot was in the fire. You know, if he let us down, he was a goner, and it would be on his record from here on.
Sure.
You know. Well, one of the things I did to keep him busy, I started this chorus
And I said, Jim, I know you're not a singer, but I need some lighting. And he built a lighting system not unlike what you've got that is portable. Mm-hmm. Only we had four different colors that we could do. Footlights, spots, the whole microphones, the whole thing, you know. And every time the choir would go out, we'd take Jim and all this equipment, which he'd set up, do the show, break down, and bring back home with us, you know. And we have joked about that so often, you know. He's gone to be with the Lord now. But he was pastor at 10th Presbyterian in Philadelphia for so long.
We couldn't articulate it as young kids at the time, young children, but we knew the place was special. We saw our parents, our fathers and our mothers literally pour out their lives into the endeavor of the Stony Brook School and into the students. And we saw our parents' example of truly giving everything to an institution, to a belief, to a cause, to other people. And though we couldn't really articulate that at the time, that was setting deep in us, this idea of serving.
And so to live in the presence of godly men and women of character who weren't your parents, who were influencing your character, I think adds a whole separate dimension to it. I sent my own children to Stony Brook for that reason. Although I think I'm a person of character and I shape my children's character, I wanted them to benefit from the influence of non-parental units, as my daughter would say, shaping their character from their own dimensions. And so having a Pearson Curtis in my life or a Marvin Goldman, and they were very different in their own, they were not a homogenous group. They were very different men and women, each with their own perspectives. But I don't know how you cannot be. We used to say character is caught, not taught, and you get it not because of the curriculum in the classroom or even the rules and regulations.
Well, there was a constant challenge when you're standing in a classroom. You realize you've got a whole bunch of new people out there. They come from all kind of backgrounds. How are you going to touch them in a way that they're going to start thinking about things that you think are important in life, and yet invite them into that process so that they themselves want to get engaged into it? So it was always something that would intrigue you about how to do that. So it wasn't running through a certain curriculum of certain subjects. There was always, you were teaching somebody, and those folks you were teaching were always different people, knew, responded differently. And of course, the ones who you were most interested in were often the ones who cared least about what you were doing. Yeah. And so you're always intrigued about, well, how can I get them involved? How can you get them engaged and that kind of thing? And so there was always that challenge, which I enjoyed a great deal. And I enjoyed talking with kids. So I had a chance to do lots of informal counseling with students, and I appreciated doing that. I enjoyed doing that, and so it was fun to get to know them personally and share in their lives what was going on in their lives and minds.
You see, your great brother has a school out in Long Island, and you really ought to go there to the school. And his name was Arnold Gable. And I said, well, I'm too young for this, but you know, he found out I had an older brother, so I. Well, he made a point, Frank Gable and his brother, to go and see my mother. And as a result, my older brother went to Stony Brook. Bill Zucker, Bob's brother, went here. I went here, Bob went here, and my younger brother went here. And because of all of that, I met Lee Burley. And I met Lee, and then we went to Amherst. Then I met Evelyn. You know, I mean, this is fantastic. Because I walked out of a choir. You know, I was mad at the other. And we have wonderful children and great-grandchildren, and I owe it all, see, to walking out of church. And that's how a little something in life determines where you are. Because had I not done that, I wouldn't be here today.
You're still around.
And, huh?
You're still around.
Yeah, I know. But I'm sure everybody's got a little story of just how it happened that you got here.
A man prior to him named Ford Ottman.
Yeah.
Ottman was a colleague of John Fleming Carson. Mm-hmm. And on the back of an envelope, sitting on the huge porch, the veranda of Hopkins Hall, he wrote those words and handed them to Carson. Ottman, by the way, enjoyed oversized Cuban cigars. And there were people in the assemblies who were both teetotalers and against the use of tobacco. And they would titch, titch, titch as Ottman lighted one of his Corona Coronas. And Ottman had a response for that. He would reach in his pocket and pull out a copy of the Long Island Railroad timetable as if to say, right down there, if you disapprove.
He was to give a devotional. He said, I'm just giving a devotional today. Well, I'd sat in on 1,000 devotionals as a student at Stony Brook, and what could be special about this? But, this one was different. This was at a breakfast at the Cosmos Club, and I didn't realize, but when I went in there, there was some senators, there was brilliant scientists, and he dragged me as the, young freshman college student there. And I was sitting in, I realized that this was a game at a much higher level. But he talked about his devotional. What I remember distinctly was he talked about people question Christ, whether he is the Son of God, and is he truly something special, or was just some guy and myths develop around him. He said he made the point that Jesus was the only one that actually overcame death. And what is the proof of that? Is that empty tomb. And he kept coming back to that empty tomb is there. And that is evidence of it. And there's a lot of people that can try and rationalize away Jesus's ministries or this or that, but they can't rationalize away that empty tomb, which is a historical fact. And though I'd been around Christianity my whole life, that was the first time it really hit me, because what he was really saying, there is apologetics. This is a faith that is not just a faith, but it can be intellectually and rationally defended by smart people and with a case to be made for it. And that was amazing to me.
He talked in a strange way. He talked in a very, I'm not even sure I can even imitate it, but every word was carefully articulated. And he would call you instantly if you mispronounced a word. I remember he had this dog he named after one of the Norse figures, Loki. And my roommate, Fred Schroeder, made a mistake one day and called the dog Loki. And Dr. Gabelion said, Frederick, you must learn to pronounce the name of the dog correctly. It's Loki. Did you hear that? Yes, sir. It's Loki. Now say Loki 15 times. Loki. Loki, sir. Loki. Loki. And, that was, and then you'd go away and you'd laugh behind his back because nobody acted like this. But in his own way, he was the quintessential headmaster from the tradition of Thomas Arnold in England in the 1800s, and the kind of person that you might not have felt close to him, but you deeply respected him.
It mainly asked me about my Christian experience, mm-hmm. and then my musical experience.
Yeah.
And the fact that I was a recording artist, mm-hmm. and in those few years since we started Word, I was the number one selling Christian recording artist in the country, mm-hmm. Of course, he was thrilled about that, because on all our album covers and everything else was Stony Brook School.
Sure.
Marketing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And he was very good at that, He knew how to get the word out to the right folks that Stony Brook combined Christianity with high academics.
In 1957, Billy Graham Crusade was in New York at Madison Square Garden. And we were all invited in to go to that crusade. And that was amazing, absolutely amazing. George Beverly Shea singing How Great Thou Art. resonates with me all the time. When we came back, we didn't realize that Dr. Graham was staying at the school. He was living in the infirmary. Mm-hmm. And the students were given opportunities to meet with Dr. Graham one-on-one. Mm-hmm. I took advantage of that. That has stayed with me over the years as I've gotten to follow Dr. Graham in Franklin and seeing his life etched firmly in the minds of hundreds of thousands, millions of people. Just phenomenal how one person can make a difference. And I've used that experience in my life, that one can make a difference in so many organizations.
We happen to be particularly connected to the community, more so in the early years. We were more connected to the community than a lot of the people at Stony Brook. If there ever was a local criticism of Stony Brook, it would be that it was too insular, too staying within its own walls. Mm-hmm. And we belonged to the local Presbyterian Church in Setauket. Mm-hmm. We had a lot of friends in the community. We were involved in civic activities. Mm-hmm. And this, we felt, was a positive thing for Stony Brook. We felt like it was an outreach to Stony Brook. And mm-hmm. Bruce was the director of admissions, and it was helpful to be able to connect with people.
This young fellow was a sharp guy, but he failed every course. I think but one. And he failed my course. And so I went to Dr. Gavin and I said, why in the world would you ever give me this young man? He said, you need to learn a lesson. He said, the world isn't always made out of tough kids. And you've got to learn how to take care and learn how to love the unlovable. And it was a big lesson. So I put him in charge of the work program, and he loved it, and he was good at it, and he became a heck of a student. And from being a total F in math, he became an actuary.
I thought it was wonderful. I mean, I think it was a privilege. And I really mean that sincerely. It's a privilege to be able to spend such a large part of my life with our children, who were always a part of the school body. I mean, the boys would come and babysit when we were out in the evening, and so it became an interaction between them. And they felt at home, and I felt very comfortable having the boys babysit, and all you had to do was put a batch of cookies and some ice cream in there. Everybody was happy.
I guess I have to start by saying I went there when Stony Brook was a Stony Brook school for boys. I'm very respectful of the fact that, of the school's decision to move into a co-educational climate. But I think they're two different schools. And while I wouldn't in any way compare them and say one was better than the other, they were two different schools. I think when you have a virtually totally male culture, it offers a way of life that's very significant. I have no way of knowing, but I'm going to guess out loud, that if I'd gone to Stony Brook at a latter time, speaking for me personally, it would have been a totally different experience. I probably in my early teen years would have been distracted by all the lovely girls around me. And I know they say, well, you become like brothers and sisters, and so what do I know? But for me, entering into a totally male context was very, very important. It was the first time I got to see disparate kinds of men, and where I became appreciative of what a man is.
The first major impression of school was, since I did not know English, in homeroom all of the boys had their homework to do with impressive textbooks. And I had comic books, Popeye's big little books that existed in that period. And after 3 days or so, Pearson Curtis leaned over me and removed the comic and put a textbook in front of me. Monsieur, je comprends pas, je parle que français. Sorry, old chap. The pages were turning faster.
Well, you know, it's so personal. I wished I could make it less selfish than this will sound. But I think the extraordinary moment for me was in my senior year when I did the declamation contest. And I so wanted to win, and it was so competitive. I had a couple other classmates who were in my class who were all in. And it was such an emotional poem written by a black poet. And because I was an African American doing a black poet in front of a pretty much of a white audience, because the community came and families came or whatever. And I don't think my parents were that wild about my doing this kind of thing. I mean, they had no problem with it and they were very proud of me, but they always saw it as, well, he wants to go off and do that acting thing. So when it was announced, and I didn't think I was going to win, I thought I may place. And when it was announced that evening, it was just before graduation, that Charles Floyd Johnson had won the declamation contest, I think it was one of the proudest moments of my life. And I think Pearson Curtis was as proud of me and as happy for me, because he had mentored me and we had sessions in class and at his house and on the campus trying to do this. And I think he was as proud of me, and I think the school was proud of me. And I think it was a very, very personal moment, but a wonderful moment.
Well, I think speaking particularly of faculty spouses, there was a time when I was having some health problems, and I got such support from everybody, even to the fact, to the extent that Norma Gable and I organized a house cleaning event one day, and they all came over and cleaned my house. And I thought, wow, that's pretty nice.
Wow.
Those kind of situations where people really encouraged and helped each other and supported each other without making a big deal of it. They just did it.
The other thing is that these people were not just mamby-mamby Christians. The people you mentioned, like Goldberg these were men of the faith.
The 50th reunion, the special thing it is, whether one just got by or was considered a student whiz. The mere fact that we survived and are here is quite a feat. And the fact that we're in attendance makes this day complete. Naturally, we're not all here. That we could not expect. But a big majority made it, and that we do respect. We've come from near and far to relive our pleasant past, and we're extremely thankful that we did all that. For those of us not present, we say a silent prayer. Let's let them know we remember them, that we really care. So 3 cheers for our 50th, wherever you may be, and let's all shout. You've come a long way, baby. We welcome our wives, Jacobson Schneider, Brolio, Jameson, Davison, and Bucher, Paul Stewart, Anderson, Shore, and Zucker, Harris, Rumpel, and almost McGinnis, Eleanor and Floyd, and our welcome is finished. Let's toast old SBS and forget her never. May the Lord keep her going now and forever. Amen. Yeah.
This is something I feel changed over the years. We could see it. Younger couples coming in and not settling for this. The mothers wanting the fathers to be more involved with their own children. And this is a good change for the school. When we came, it was the first year, really, that faculty members didn't have to move out of their apartments every summer and store all of their belongings.
To make room for the assembly.
And then, right. And this was, we avoided that, fortunately. Mm-hmm. It took a while for the school to shift into more of a family orientation rather than the old, almost British style boys' school, and with masters. And the more they were able to let the family be involved and let the fathers be involved with their children, the better, which has been the trend in raising children, which is a good one.
I know of one person that clearly paved the way for his exit. And Dr. Gabeline interviewed the kid and reviewed the circumstances and decided that that young man needed another chance. And I remember, as a faculty member, I didn't think he was right. But now I know he was right because of the way that young man turned out. He's a very outstanding Christian.
You think he had a good read on people's character?
He had very good vision with that.
Discernment.
I would say his discernment in that case was just outstanding. And I learned, again, a lot of times Dr. Gabeline was a mentor when he didn't know he was being, when he was being so. He was influencing people in the right direction. And sort of makes things like Psalm 1 stand out. You know? You're not supposed to be hanging around with people that are identified by their wrongdoing, you know, and go into the influences that are right.
And my one other thing that I would tell you about Stony Brook and race at that time, and this was 58, was I fitted in very well, and all my friends, of course, were white because they were, that's all you had. And I was in New York City one day with four of my classmates, and we were walking down the street. And there was a mirror, and I looked into the mirror, and I saw four white faces, and one black face. And suddenly, I went, who's that black guy? It was the oddest thing. But color had become unimportant, and it was not that I wanted to be white, I just fitted in, and we didn't think about it. And then, years later, when I reflected on that sort of moment, I thought the danger of that was if I had really wanted to be, not be black, and had, but I didn't, and I always thought, don't ever let that happen to you again. But it was also an interesting kind of revelation that I had blended in so well that the fact of color did not matter and didn't matter to my friends, and we never talked about it. I joked one time we were on Hegeman Hall and they were all sunbathing, all my friends, and I came up to sunbathe and they went, do you do this? And I said, well, why not? And then we joked about, you know, I can tan, I just get a little darker than you are. But those are the fun things you do in school. And so that would be what I'd want to say to future generations and people who are considering Stony Brook.
I think there was a general feeling, it was a great moment, that here we were, from well-intentioned families and everything, and here we were gathered together to do something, and in a way we did it. Not maybe so many outstanding people from the first classes we got later on, but we started off on the way it wanted to go.
Yeah.
Didn't it, Gil? I think.
They need to know that the school knew what it was from the start and was utterly faithful to what it was, its mission. A Christian education in the fullest sense of the term. Not narrow. No social issues tied up to it. No litmus tests. Just the example of good Christian faculty and become a good Christian human being yourself. And take that verse in Micah, to do justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. Okay, the school, find a school that knows what it is and is faithful to that. Find a school that's got its priorities right with its faculty first, and that is a teaching institution, and the rest of it will follow. That to me is where it all starts.
The great danger of all good works like he founded is that there would be forces that moved in and not necessarily on purpose or with intent, but that would water down or destroy what he began. And in a way that, it's not really he that began it. He had the vision, but the foundation is Jesus Christ. And I think we need to keep that in mind as we apply our own agendas, our own personalities, and all the rest. It really isn't about him. He would be the first one to say, look, I founded this school not to honor me, but to honor God. It's great that you have my name on the library, but make sure that you maintain Jesus in your heart and the mind of Christ in your head and see things as he does, and you'll be fine. I think that is the outstanding legacy of the school that he founded, and I would hope that it would maintain that in 50 or 100 years. If it doesn't, it will lose its reason for being, and even if it continues as a school, it will discontinue as a kind of force for the kingdom of God that he intended it to be.
In the final analysis, Stony Brook School was started as a place where Jesus was the supreme one to be honored, that all of life and learning would be filtered by Jesus' view of history and life and as Savior of the world. And as long as Frank Gaebelein was there, there was never a question about that. And long after Dr. Gaebelein left the school and went to be with the Lord, the following generations have maintained that deep love for Jesus. And not just in a doctrinal sense, but in the practicality of the way Jesus came and taught us how to live. My great hope for the school is it will never lose that. It will never lose that emphasis upon character.
And I think that's the ongoing vision. Mm-hmm. The commitment to the truth and the value of persons with an understanding that of the school hymn. We take for our foundation the word forever laid. And I don't know how to put it any better than that. That's where the vision needs to be going. I think that's the mainstream of however it's articulated.
Preserve the integrity of the board with believers. That's the first crack in the foundation when you begin adding people simply because they have influence or they have wealth and not because of their commitment to the theology of the school. Hire a head who mirrors that, who will in turn hire administrators and faculty who mirror that same commitment. It's not easily done, but it's the absolute necessity. And Peter Hale, my colleague for many, many years and dear friend, used to speak about a school that is as Christian as possible.
I truly believe that it's the best school that there is, because Stony Brook is not just about making you smarter to get into a better college, it's about making you a better person, and it will confront you with Jesus Christ. And that is something special. But
I think they need to know that Stony Brook is a very special place. It not only looks out for their academic life, but for their spiritual life, for their concerns, for their needs, for their problems. They need to know that the faculty is there at any time that they need help. The faculty is there to help them in their spiritual walk as well as their academic walk, and athletics as well, but athletics is secondary. Athletics are not the most important thing.
What's most important?
The most important thing is their relationship with Jesus Christ, and they can't help but go to Stony Brook and not understand that. It's up to them whether they accept it or not, but you can't go to Stony Brook and not know and hear about the Lord Jesus and how much he loves you. And wants you to love him in return. And I think that's one of the things that makes it special.
again, what I think they need to know is just the role it has had in people like myself, where I constantly think back with gratitude for the rounded education of the academic, the physical, and above all the spiritual that I had there.
But we're coming up to a period in American history where we need a total reformation in our American way of life. And we need a new kind of leader. And so my hope for Stony Brook would be it would be one of those places that has a fresh vision for the kind of leadership that's going to be needed as we move further and further into this 21st century. And that we will see here and there a young man or a young woman come out who knows how to lead a corporation or lead a Christian a dimension of the Christian movement, and or to be a researcher or a physician or whatever. And these will be people that will mark the future of our country.
And I just think that the faculty and students at Stony Brook need to appreciate and savor that high quality of Christian education that Frank Gebelein started with that school. He never accepted second best. He never accepted compromise. He said, if it's worth believing in, it's worth going whole hog, all the way. And I just hope our students and faculty 50-100 years from now will still feel that way about what they get at Stony Brook.
What then is this day of the Lord, this Yom Jehovah, to use its Hebrew name? It is not a 24-hour day, but a long period of time ushered in by Christ's return in glory and ending with the purification of the heavens and earth by fire prior to the new order. In other words, it is one of the great prophetic themes, a concept of judgment, restoration, and glory. Now it is noteworthy that Joel introduces this theme out of the purely local setting of the locust plague. Thus he is one of the first to illustrate a leading character of Bible prophecy, the use of a local circumstance as the base for a prophecy of wide and even universal scope.
I was promoted to full professor. Well, of course, I was elated, and the first person I wanted to tell was Mr. Curtis. So when I told him, I went to him, and I was just bubbling over with enthusiasm and excitement, expecting some great comments from him. And I said, I've been promoted to a full professor. And he looked at me with a sort of amazement on his face, put his hand on my shoulder. This was 3 years. He said, what took you so long? That is the kind of relationship that has sustained me all through my life. And many, many times when we've had some rather hair-raising experiences, missionaries. And when I was tempted many times to stop and give up, it was always a sense of obligation to the fidelity of that man, the relationship of that man, that the Lord used to sort of bow my head and knuckle me down.